Welcome to the West End Video Newsletter. My name is Joe LoPiccolo, your host for this week's newsletter. Well, we're fortunate this week to have some very interesting guests. We have some representatives from Suffolk University here today who are going to be talking about a project they've been involved with regarding the old West End. And they've taken it upon themselves to, they've interviewed many former residents of the West End regarding their memories before they took it down over 30 years ago, before these residents were displaced. And I'll introduce my guest today. First, we have Professor Jerry Manning, Associate Professor of the Sociology Department of Suffolk University, and Yadira and Trish, who are students at Suffolk. Welcome to the show, Jerry, Professor Manning. And can you tell us how long you've been at Suffolk?
This is my eighth year as a faculty person at Suffolk. And prior to that time, I was at Suffolk from 1970 to 1972 as a student. So it's been interesting to come back in some respects to my home, and a very pleasant experience as well.
That's great. You've risen from a student in your alma mater and you're a professor. That's wonderful. And how did you first get interested in the West End project?
Well, when I was a student at Suffolk, I had an early sociology class in which we were presented with some of the sociological accounts of the destruction of the community. And I had read Gans's The Urban Villages and Mark Fried's article on Grieving for a Lost Home.
Those are two great pieces.
Yes. And it truly sparked my interest. In fact, when I went on to graduate school, my area, or one of my areas of interest, was community life. And I found myself, when I returned to Suffolk, thinking about a way back into this area, and I thought, where better to go than the neighborhood that abuts the university?
Mm-hmm.
And to some degree, it was a painful experience for some of my students, because I think we're now reaching the point where a generation of students may not have heard about the West End. And the first sociology class where I was presenting lecture material on urban renewal and the process that went on in the West End, students looked absolutely devastated.
Mm-hmm.
And a couple of them came up to me and said, "What can we do?" And I really was surprised that they didn't know. But then as I thought about it, I began to realize I'm getting on in years and that they're not of my generation. And it was at that point that I decided there's a special program at Suffolk that's called the Outreach Fellows Program. And this is a program that creates special educational opportunities for students who are academically gifted. And that I decided at that point to offer what we call a challenge seminar on the neighborhoods of Boston. And when the class met for the first time and I asked them what were they most interested in, the West End was the area that they wanted to
concentrate in. That is a surprise. And that's a natural too, because as everybody knows, Suffolk University is located right by the State House and right on Beacon Hill, and right above where the West End was torn down.
Yes, so. And in some respects, it did seem like the most logical direction to go. And when we first tried to orient the students, they had read some of the sociological and social psychological materials, and then we went down to the West End Library and spent some time talking with the librarian there, Paula Posnick,
mm-hmm.
and also exploring some of the vertical files that the library has collected over the years. And at that point, I gave the students the opportunity to see some of the film footage of the destruction. And the students decided at that point that their way to make a contribution and to do something so that, as one student said to me, so people will never forget,
mm-hmm.
would be to try to do as many interviews as we could with former West End residents.
And you also have another member of your faculty who's been involved with the West End project,
yes.
And that's Professor Robbins.
Yes, Dean David Robbins has been a longstanding supporter of the West End Historical Association and of the work that's being done. And I think to some degree also when David was first doing some of this work, he had contacted me and he said, you know, we're both interested in, he said, I in local history and you in community life. He said, you really should become involved. And at that point, I'm sorry to say, I didn't jump right in. And I said, I don't know if I could do one more thing. And then as it became, I noticed part of the material that I would cover in my courses, and that the students seemed so deeply troubled by what had happened and very interested in becoming more involved. I said to myself that, you know, I have to remember I'm a teacher first, and that if that was, if I was going to go in that direction, mm-hmm. then so be it. And it's been really a very interesting project, because for me, I found myself able to really read materials and go over materials that I had read 10 or 20 years ago. And as I would listen to individuals' accounts of their lives, it was clear to me, I was happy to say, that the social scientists that had studied the West End had done a fine job, mm-hmm. but also that the pain is still there, and that the hurt has in some cases never gone away. And I think it's important for students to connect with that history, mm-hmm. and to understand that mistakes have been made, and that things haven't always worked out for the best, and that in this case, it's a tragedy.
I could attest to that, because I grew up in the West End myself, and I still have the pain from my home being taken, so I could attest to that also, yeah. your experience.
I do notice that when the students saw the film for the first time in the library, I had about 20 students with me, and there were a number of students who I saw wiping their eyes.
Mm.
And I thought it has a tremendous amount of power, and that the students identified with the loss that these folks had gone through.
And I understand you also have some students in your class who are the children of
yes.
former West Enders.
Yes, and it seems that every time I present this material, one or two students come forward and say, you know, my grandmother came from there. My mother came from that neighborhood. And in some cases, I have found myself on the lead to new possible interviews mm-hmm. As a result of presenting the material in class.
Oh, great. And how the students, the reaction, like you're telling me, has been positive towards the course?
Yes.
And what has your experience been? Have you, like, listened into the interviews
yes.
and part of them? And
yes.
What has your experience been there?
Well, I think, again, you're struck with, I'm always struck with people's openness and honesty and the fact that they are willing to share their story. I know in one particular case, there's a woman who's in our university, and this is an interesting story, a woman who continues to live in one of the elderly housing projects in the neighborhood in the mm-hmm. West End, and she is now 92 years old. And at one point, I went down to the West End Library to do something, and as I was picking up some material, one of the librarians introduced me to one of the patrons. And as I introduced myself, she said to me, oh, I know all about you. And I said, you do? And she said, oh, yes. She said, Rosalie Warren has told me all about you. And Rosalie has returned to Suffolk. She came back quite late in life as part of our elders program.
Isn't that wonderful? How old is Rosalie?
Rosalie is now 92.
My God.
And Rosalie comes up the hill 3 days a week on two canes, and she says that this is something that more elders should do. They need to get out of the house. They need to stay in the world. And she is very much engaged, and I know that one of my students, when I had asked them, I know that the Historical Association had some tapes that hadn't been transcribed, and one student said to me, I don't feel that I'm yet ready to do an interview, but I would love to transcribe a tape and produce a printed document. And she said, who could I do? And when I began to tell her that Rosalie Warren was one of the early interviews, she said, I love that woman.
Mm.
She said, could I do her? I said, I think it would be fine. And she said she learned so much. And Rosalie, I think, continues to carry, in her own way, the message of the West End back up to
she
the
sure
university.
Does. Well, that's wonderful. Oh. That's quite a story. You've also been involved in a project, Professor Mark Fried from Boston College.
Yes. Yes.
He had some materials that of interviews that he had done
yes.
many, many years ago. Can you tell us something?
Yes. Again, it was fascinating to me as a social scientist to have an opportunity to see what we would call the primary documents. The Professor Fried, when the work was being done many years ago with some of the residents, he had access to that material, and he shared it with us so that we could provide the Historical Association with a duplicate copy. To some degree, as students and others who are interested in the West End went to, in this case, the library to look at the vertical files, we didn't really have the opportunity to provide too many primary documents. And so Professor Freed has been coordinating with our university to get a second copy made so that we can, in fact, share with our neighbors what we're learning, which I think is an appropriate use of the university.
I know you're so busy with your students. Have you had time to read any of these?
Yes. I think, again, as a sociologist, my parents, when I first told them I was going to be a sociologist, laughed and said, oh, you're going to be a professional busybody and nosy person. And the truth to tell, the first day that a tape came from a student and the first day that the first box came from Professor Freed, it was during the end of a term, and I sat right down and had to play the tape and wanted to read the file. And I think, again, it's convinced me of the importance of sharing this information with others, because I do think one of the things I appreciate as a sociologist is that there are different ways of life, mm-hmm. and that we as a nation have to learn to value those different ways of life. And I, at one point, very cavalierly said in one of my classes that in some cases when the West End was slated for destruction, that there was a real insensitivity to a way of life that was a functioning unit. It was providing people with emotional and psychological satisfaction, and that while it may not look like Wellesley and it doesn't look like Dover, that it could be as satisfying, if not more satisfying, than life in some more affluent communities. And many of my students identified with that, and I think also because of the fact that they had themselves come from neighborhoods that were in some cases very ethnically diverse and in some cases living in multiple unit dwellings, that they understood what it was like to live in close quarters with others and the way in which that could enrich a person's overall life existence. And so I have found reading those documents and watching the tapes pure pleasure. And sometimes I think to myself, if I had time away from my teaching responsibilities, which I like very much, but I could have a career going in this direction, enjoying the interviewing, because I really do find that the material that's presented is both very honest and forthright and very engaging and emotionally charged, mm-hmm. that people still have very strong feelings of positive pleasure of living in the community and genuine pain at what had happened to them.
But one of the things that disturbs me the most is when we speak to the development of this the new West End, the Charlesville Park, which I don't consider a community anyway. We hear the story that he has no remorse for what they did to the West End because he created a new community and he tore down a slum. And I don't consider it that. And during the interviews, the people's feelings were not that way, were they?
No, not at all. And I think one of the things that one student one day when we were talking about this subject came up to me afterwards and said, it's too bad that the developer never understood that what he had called a slum was somebody's lovely home.
And to this today, he still doesn't understand, no matter what, we try to project that to him, and he still doesn't understand that.
I think it's regrettable, but I think as I've tried to analyze some of the material, I do think that when, and this may begin to sound like a sociology lecture, but I think that when people go on to be trained in a profession, that the type of work that they go into, they often reinforce a set of values and a way of life mm-hmm. that takes them away from the values that they may have grown up with or values of those that they may encounter. And I really think that much of the perspective of the developer is what I would call an upper middle class, more privileged perspective, and that his sense is if the world is not like my world, then it's not okay.
Well, they're right down the street from Suffolk University.
Yes,
perhaps
they are.
We could get them into one of your classes and give them a little history and so forth and so on. One of the things we found too in speaking to former West Enders, and including myself, is that they've never found a place like the West End when they've moved. Did you find that reading the interviews?
Yes, and I think that, again, it's important to understand that, again, a lot of the people that are engaged in practices of development have spent many, many years trying to figure out how to develop a livable community. And I think if there is one lesson to be learned, I think that we need to understand that it is not easy to create that kind of environment. And when a community is working for its citizenry, that needs to be held as a high value and not be disturbed as if it's something that just can be recreated anywhere. Because if we've learned anything from this, we should have learned that it cannot be recreated.
You've said it all, Jerry. I don't have to say any more. Okay, we're going to break away for a few minutes for a videotape of the students' work here, and see you back in a few minutes.
Where did I go to school? I went to school. At the time that I grew up, the West End had so many children that schools were in categories. Elementary school, kindergarten through grade 3. We went to the Mayhew School on Chamber Street. And then when we got promoted into fourth grade, we went to the Winchell School on Boston Street. And we stayed there fourth grade 4 through 6. And then we went across the street to the junior high school, which was the William Blackstone School. Again, I think on Boston Street. And that was 7 to 9. And then trauma. We had to leave the West End Sports School. For high school.
Oh, for high school.
Yeah. We had to get on a bus, get on the streetcar, go on the subway, and leave that little safe place that we had never left for school because everything was in walking distance.
Did you divide the West End in neighborhoods?
Yes.
Uh-huh. Which neighborhoods?
Well, we have very definite sections, certain streets. Where I grew up, Norman Street, Hale Street, Pitt Street, Green, South Margin, and Sanford. And that kind of was kind of our boundaries because we all went to the same school and we all went so that everybody kind of, that was the basis of your friends. And all of those girls are still, that I grew up with are still my friends.
Oh.
But when you went into other classrooms and you met kids from the other areas, you know, Chamber Street or Auburn Street, they became your school friends. And so you had very, very, very definite separations. And when you got out of school, I didn't. I had so many friends. Every building had 20 kids. You didn't have to go anyplace. You didn't have to go to Chamber Street or Auburn Street because, you know, there was 20 kids in the building. So you didn't, that's the way it worked out.
That was like your social place, your own building.
Yeah. So when you got home, you just see who was home or who was doing something. And I mean, really, the furthest they ever went was the girls in the next street. And as I said, we are all still friends.
See, what were the advantages of living in the West End?
What were the advantages?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, you never had to be lonely, and you never had to be bored. And I didn't realize it until I moved in the suburbs and I had children. And I would watch them, especially girls. Girls get, you know, if you live in the city, it's 30 girls or 20 girls. So if you have a fight with one of them, you say, I'm not going to bother with you. Okay, I'm not going to go with you. You go with somebody else.
The West End, was it divided into ethnic pockets?
No, everybody lived together. But the whole area, they say Chamber Street was a very interesting street. And when you say, were they pockets? You'd have a tenement house where on one floor there'd be a Polish family, the next floor would be a Jewish family and an Italian family, all living together.
Yeah.
And they all got accustomed to everybody else's customs.
Right.
If a Catholic died, an Italian died, the Jews would go to the wake. And if a Jew died, they'd come to the house to comfort.
Mm-hmm.
And bring food.
Yeah.
And there was no demarcation as to you all neighbors. And if a neighbor needed help, they'd get it from another neighbor.
Yeah.
If somebody was sick, the Jewish woman probably would bring some Jewish chicken soup, you see? And the Italians would bring some spaghetti or whatever. But it was one of these neighborhoods where there was some black people in the neighborhood, too, and you didn't even notice.
Uh-huh.
I mean, nobody said anything about black.
Yeah.
They could live in the same house with you, and nobody even paid attention to the fact they were different in
yeah.
color. But this is the way the West End was. And unfortunately, it was broken up by this Urban Renewal.
Mm.
And that was a very tragic situation because they didn't have to do it in the way they did.
Look, we're back live right now, and I hope you enjoyed the insert that we just ran. And we're going to go to our next guest, Yadira. Welcome to the show.
Thanks.
And you're a student at Suffolk University. You're a senior. Okay. Yadira, tell us, how did you enjoy your experience with this project?
It all started when I took my seminar in Boston with Professor Manning. And first I really didn't know what had happened. And she started talking about these people being removed from their houses and everything. And I thought it was very surprising, especially because I'm so used to just see buildings and those things in Boston that I thought it was very interesting. And when she asked us if we could wanted to interview somebody after we had already seen a speaker at the library, I thought that was very interesting, and I
Great.
Was really into doing it.
And you're yeah. from what country? You come
Costa Rica.
From? Oh,
yes.
Welcome. And have you enjoyed your stay here?
Oh, yes, I love it.
Oh, great.
You like it, yes.
Tell us, who did you interview for your project?
I interviewed Eleanor Venetia. Actually, her single name was Spinelli when she lived there before she got married. I was very interested in her because she was telling me things of how life was in the West End, and it was much like it was in Costa Rica for me. You know all your neighbors, and it looks like everybody in the town is your family.
Right, the
your
closeness family. Of it. That's
exactly, and which I really don't find in other places. Mm-hmm. Where I live, I don't even know who my neighbor is.
Mm-hmm.
And she was telling me about this, having all your friends always there, going with you. The people that she went to school with were her friends and people that she knew. And I guess the people that always was there for her, were always there for her.
Mm-hmm.
And
so yes, you saw they say you felt like you were home again when you interviewed her.
Yes, but it also was nostalgic to think that if I ever went back home and suddenly they say, oh no, this is not your house anymore because we remove everybody, we're gonna make buildings, we're gonna build buildings. I just couldn't think that would happen to me. I mean, I'd be devastated if that ever happened. And I know I'm gonna live here for probably the rest of my life, but every time I go to Costa Rica, I wanna find the same place I left.
I know what you mean, because I felt that way, because that's what happened to me. Can you tell us something interesting in your interview there? Is there one highlight that you, or one or two highlights that you find?
Yes, one of the first things is that she was telling me how when you're friends and when you're just a little girl, and she was telling me, you go to school, you have so many friends, and you don't have to worry about getting in a fight with somebody because you still have so many other friends to go with.
Mm-hmm.
And she says that now where she lived once when her little girl said to her, Mom, I had a fight with somebody and I don't have friends anymore. And she said, what do you mean you don't have friends anymore? And she said, well, she really meant she only had two friends because she had a fight with one and the other one decided to side with the other person, then that she didn't have any more friends.
I can understand what she's saying because growing up in the West End, it was like that. People would argue or come to a couple of blows, but then a minute later, they shake hands and make up and be friends again. You don't have that today.
Exactly. That's what she was telling. She said to me, you know, you'll find school, and then when you went back home, you start playing again. And
exactly.
It didn't really matter. And so I think that the part that she missed most about the West End was her friends being able to just go to somebody. And she said, I never needed to go far away from my house. My building was my social place,
right,
where I had all my friends.
Yeah, you know, your building and the street in front is was our social place. It was a corner. Everybody hung around a corner, yeah, and everybody knew each other from that
exactly
corner, and it was great.
That's what you said.
Oh, very good. And we have our next guest is Trish. Welcome, Trish. And you're
mm-hmm
also a senior from Suffolk?
Yes, that's right.
And you also have another sideline that you do. You work for the federal
government. Yeah, I work for the National Park Service, in particular Boston National Historical Park.
Oh, great.
And I conduct feed and till tours, among other things.
Okay. And tell us what your interest in the West End. How was your experience?
Well, my interest in the West End came through Dr. Robbins. I'm an Archer Fellow, and I took a seminar, Boston by Foot, and on one of our outings, we walked through the towers.
The West End development there.
Yeah, that, yeah.
Charles River Park.
That's it, thank you. And he was telling us how this was a neighborhood once, and I'm looking around and saying, it was a neighborhood, and he started talking about it, and I remembered from being really young about this development going on, and things started to click, and I became interested that way. And then next year, I took Dr. Manning's seminar, Boston Social Neighborhoods, and from there I got interested and more exposed to the West End and to the interviews and that process there, and that's how I really, you know, got to do the interviews. I sort of volunteered, well, that's what I'll do for my my project, so.
Great. And who did you interview?
Gladys Shapiro.
Oh, Gladys. Tell
yeah
us a little bit about Gladys.
I could tell you a lot about Gladys.
Okay.
I just don't, that problem is knowing where to begin. Gladys is a really interesting person to interview. I really enjoyed doing her. She was so progressive. I think that's the thing that I picked up most on with her, is how progressive she was for being back in that time. And I got a little different aspect on the West End from her point of view. She still lives there. She's never really had to live. She's one of the few fortunate people. And I'm not sure if many, you know, West Enders consider where she lived West End, but she does. So she, you know, she was still there, and she was, oh, where do I begin? She was a lawyer, which was kind of interesting to have a female lawyer at that time.
She was on the Save the West End Committee,
yeah,
also.
Yeah,
she was involved
right
in that.
Yeah, very active politically and on a civic level. She was into a lot of different groups.
Did she tell you a little story about the Lamazny era?
Oh, yeah.
Did you tell us about
the
that?
Ward boss? Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, she was telling me that, well, he was the Democratic ward boss, and he had a falling out with the Democratic candidate at that time, so he wanted everyone to vote for the Republican candidate. And the way that he manipulated this was to give all of his people hard pencils, so that when they went in to mark the ballot, he could tell just by looking at the impression on the ballot how they voted. And for those that didn't vote the correct way, he would talk to them, and they would shortly thereafter lose their jobs.
Mm-hmm.
And this got out really quickly, so he didn't have any problem the next time around, and he got his candidate in.
So that went on in those days.
Yeah,
huh?
Yeah,
okay.
It's a true affirmation of it. You know, you read about it in books, even in movies and that, and here's someone telling me she actually, you know, was in a witness this. So.
Oh, great.
That's pretty neat.
Well, that's wonderful. I'm glad you enjoy your experience in your West End project. And, Jerry, we're going to get back to you for a minute.
Mm-hmm.
You had an experience recently with some students who had come in from Denmark, is it?
They came from Holland.
Holland, okay.
Yes. There were a group of students that had come to Boston last summer, and there were about 20 graduate students in social geography. And I had been asked as a community service to take them around the greater Boston area. And when I met them that morning at the John Hancock Tower, we had a bus hired, and we were ready to spend 5 hours with them and go out wherever they wanted to go. And when I first met them, the first thing they said is, please take us to the West End. And I chuckled and I said, my goodness, if I knew that you really wanted to go to the West End, we could have walked and we could have stayed for the day. And they said, oh, from our first day in graduate school, it's in every textbook that internationally this is considered one of the best examples of bad planning.
Mm-hmm.
And we want to see it for ourselves. So we spent an hour or two in the area, and they were fascinated and felt that they knew a great deal about the neighborhood and wanted to know about the people and we talked a bit about it, and we still communicate with each other.
Isn't that wonderful? Mm-hmm. Amazing, all the way from Holland.
From Holland,
wow,
yes.
That's great. Okay, we enjoyed having you on the show today. It was very interesting, and perhaps we'll do another show. I know we didn't have really enough time to go into what we wanted then. See you at the next West End Video Newsletter.